still on, right? Light's still on, is that what you mean?
Oh, is that still?
Yeah. We need to...
The annual meeting was announced for 7:30 PM on September 3rd at the Moses Mason House, featuring the election of officers and trustees, presentation of the Marjorie MacArthur Knoll Volunteer Service Award, and a presentation on prehistory of the Androscoggin River by Nathan Hamilton of the University of Southern Maine. A nominating committee consisting of Amy Davis, Don Brown, and Betty Perkins was selected to develop a proposed slate of officers and two trustees. President Hosterman reminded attendees of the first hall lecture on August 7th and the quilt show by the Middle Intervale Meeting House Society on August 22nd. The gifts of the month, donated by Sally Taylor, were two books written by a former Bethel resident, Bob Nichols, who was a well-known firearms expert. The book titles were Skeet and How to Shoot It and The Shotgunner. The evening program was a presentation by Richard Frazier of East Poland on Maine-made automobiles. He described with slides Maine's rich legacy in this field dating back to 1834. The meeting ended with refreshments and a social period. Respectfully submitted, Walter Hatch, Secretary.
Are there any additions, corrections, omissions to the minutes? And they stand approved as read. And the treasurer's report for the second. Our beginning balance was $3,352.88. The income for the month was $5,538.61. Expenditures $6,466.09, leaving a balance of $2,434.48. We also have the financial statements, the audit statements here, if anyone wants to look at them. Any questions, omissions, questions for Becky? And there you go. Treasurer's report will stand approved as read. Are there any committee reports other than non-committee? Any old business? New business? The next meeting is October 1st, and it's once at night. I hope Ernie Andrewine's coming. He always knows all the answers. And collectibles. So anyone with a collection of items and or a what's it should please bring them to the meeting. The gift of the month is a scrapbook that was compiled by Helen Varner after 43 years of teaching in Bethel. And it is a gift from her. All the things that went on. Did it stand? Is it just when she retired? Was
it also together all the list, for her? Every student she ever had.
She's also given us lots of other things too that relate to her teaching and pictures of kids and so forth. So please come and look at that. And then we have a new book at the museum store, American Dad's Ball Painting, which is for sale. Bethel is mentioned in here. The cost is roughly $10. Thank you.
1987, the society has honored outstanding volunteers who have personified the generosity and spirit of volunteerism that Marjorie MacArthur Gold extolled, and we want to honor those people who unselfishly serve the society on many fronts. It's always a hard decision to make, and obviously there are many other people that will eventually probably get the award. We can only give one a year, so it's very difficult. And Judy Haskell, who chairs the committee, knows what it's like, and Barbara Brown and George Knoll, who serve on the committee as well. The ninth recipient has served the society since its earliest days. She was active in forming the organization and assisting on many fronts. She's one of the few living incorporators we have left in the society, and she headed the annual homecoming days in the early 1970s and was very active in those early days. She worked on getting the house nominated to the National Register and served as a trustee chairman for several years. She also headed the furnishings committee when the house was being furnish the house and getting it set up. She has been a generous donor of artifacts to the society through the years and has donated to its endowment fund on several occasions. In recent years, she's been very active in assisting with various family reunions, particularly those of the main families, Kimballs and Masons. For the past 7 years, she's been working with the Kimballs, and for the past 4 years with the Masons. She's a charter member. She's also an honorary member, which is the society's highest membership award. And it's my great pleasure and honor to present the 1992 award. And I'm going to have Rob Knoll actually make the presentation to Elizabeth Carr.
Look at the geology of the drainage and give you a sense of the high quality of the archaeological record, which is a result of the annual floods that have taken place here over the past 10,000 years. I have conducted some work out here at the Bethel Airport when the construction for the extension of the runway was taking place. And about 4 years ago, I conducted a very intensive study of the Rumford impoundment for Boise Cascade as they were relicensing the impoundment for the Federal Energy Regulation Commission. We examined 35 prehistoric sites along the shores of that impoundment, which date from 9,500 years ago to 1700 AD. And we found one of the largest intact sites of the time period 1600 to 1700 AD that has been seen in the uplands of Maine. That site matches, in terms of the artifacts, a location which is down in the Pajebscot impoundment in the lowlands of the Androscoggin drainage, and further matches two archaeological sites that are found in Casco Bay, one at the Cape Elizabeth Headlands and one in Mosier Island in the town of Yarmouth. So we are going to take a look at four archaeological sites and show you a series of slides that illustrate the reason why we were doing this work, which is to assess and evaluate the erosion that is taking place along the river. The river has changed dramatically in its past 10,000 years. In a very brief sense, in the conclusion, I would like to show you some of the contact period, 1600 and 1700 AD material, that we are finding in archaeological sites that match these pieces of pottery and stone tools we're finding in the upland area here. In a general sense, I think that 5-10 years down the road, we will find that the Androscoggin River Valley will be one of the most productive archaeological areas to be investigated in the Northeast. And I think that the area from Rumford up through to Aziskahas Lake, we will find will reflect one of the most intense occupations and one of the occupations that remained relatively intact after the Europeans first settled on the coast here. And it's kind of interesting. This has been our problem, to find out the nature and the livelihood of the people that lived in the Androscoggin drainage from about 1600 to 1680 AD. I think most of you are familiar with stories relating to Molly Ockett. At least my first introduction to this area was the examination of a purse that was manufactured and attributed to Molly Ockett, which is now at the Maine State Museum in the 12,000-year archaeological exhibit. So we'll look at a series of archaeological sites, a few tools, and at the end I have about 10 slides of maps which reflect the map history of Western Maine from about 1619, Champlain's time, up to the mid-1700s. I believe that the people that were living in the uplands of the Androscoggin drainage managed to live through the epidemics of the 16-teens and the 1630s and maintained themselves later than most of the Native Americans, with the exceptions of Penobscots and Passamaquoddies. So this is very much geared to the latter part of the prehistory of the Northeast. Okay. I've just got a couple of introductory slides that show you what we're contending with in the Northeast and where my focus is. The Northeastern cultural area is a very extensive area which corresponds with the temperate forest, the spruce, fir, and mixed deciduous forest of the Great Lakes over to the Gulf of Maine. The area in here in Western Maine is particularly interesting to us because we have an upland environment, a seaboard lowland, and a marine environment tied to the drainage. And the people that were living in the upper Androscoggin were at least making their way down to the coast in prehistory and using resource in a series of different environmental zones. My principal focus for archaeology has been in the Casco Bay, Androscoggin, Kennebec, and Saco drainages. And I have focused in this area because at 1000 AD, about 900 years ago, corn farming agriculture slowly makes its way north from southern New England and reaches the Saco and Androscoggin drainages, which is its northern extension, before the Europeans made contact. So these folks here changed their way of life from hunting, fishing, and gathering to an agricultural village setting. And I believe that a series of the sites we have found along the river reflect that agricultural village. I've concentrated most of my efforts in and around the Casco Bay region. One of the things that's of particular importance is outlining the culture, history, just the artifacts. And this is the only slide like this that I have. But this shows a 9,000 to contact period record. And most of what archaeologists use to assign a prehistoric site to a culture period is the type or style of arrowhead or spear point. And you see over here stone bowls and pottery vessels, which are very recent in time. The materials that we are finding over in the Rumford area reflect this 9 to 10,000 year time frame. But what we are most interested in are these late pottery vessels and these late styles of projectile points, which reflect the Native Americans living in this particular drainage. Well, this is a shot of the impoundment as we were working over in Rumford, and I must say that working there from September until November 29th, it was beautiful in September. It was wonderful in October. But excavating on the river around Thanksgiving time was a cold spell. One of the things that we have to contend with for the sites is some of these things structured in the river for the old logging industry. And some of those features, we're standing on a site that's 9,500 years old near the outlet of the project. Well, some of you may have seen this hallmark up towards Rumford Center. One of the areas we were looking at turned out not to be a prehistoric site, but one of the old ferry crossings across the river. We were excavating holes, and we kept finding more and more historic period artifacts. In fact, we found about 12,000 historic period artifacts across the 35 sites that we excavated. This shows a typical site that we're working on, a plowed field, which has been cut over for hay, and you can see a series of flags where we selected to excavate test units. What we were doing was evaluating how much erosion had taken place along the shore of the impoundment and how it was influencing the sites. Are they going to be eroded in 5 years, 10 years? Are they going to be eroded in the 30-year period of the license to run the dam? Most of them are not undergoing erosion, but some are undergoing dramatic erosion. And this shows you one of the things that we were contending with. We're looking at the undercutting of materials, and there are hundreds of archaeological artifacts eroding out of this tree root matrix. In fact, over 2,000 stone artifacts were recovered eroding from this one feature. One of the things that's important is these large trees hold many of the archaeological sites intact. And this shows a problem, another view of the same site. Well, this is a run-of-the-river operation, so the water didn't go up and down very much, and we didn't have a chance to get out into the river to see how many materials were there. But this shows a typical type of matrix we're working in. I must say, I have never encountered so much poison ivy in my life as I did along the river. Three of my students that worked on the project ended up in the hospital over in Rumford to get cortisone shots, and we found one of the things that will protect these archaeological sites from being disturbed. This is a shot of people digging right adjacent to those trees, and it illustrates the type of approach we have. We're working right on the edge of the impoundment, and we're looking at the structure of the site and trying to find out how much remains of it. This site here is about 800, 900 years old. It's relatively young for the prehistoric record. Well, this is a typical type of excavation unit. When you see this in comparison with some of the other units, you'll get a sense that this isn't all that exciting. A plow zone, little flood zone, and then some sand which was deposited perhaps 8, 9, 10,000 years ago. Most of the material is in the upper portion here, very shallow deposit. Well, this shows one of the things that we rarely encountered, but and it's a little bit out of focus. We dug a unit down about 3 inches and hit bedrock. A couple of places we found bedrock, and they were very controlling features for the geology. This is also one of the things that I think was most interesting about the project, is assigning an age to the trees along the river. By looking at historic maps and historic fence lines and getting a sense of the timing of these trees, these ones being about 70, 80 year range, we could tell if the river had been eroding after historic land use began in the 18th century. And here's some of my folks. Oh, I think this must be one of those late October, November shots. One of the other things that we had to contend with, and this was several years ago, was the high water from a very large-scale flood that occurred in the upper Androscoggin. And I'll show you some of the effects of that on the sites. As you can see, some of the archaeological deposits were very deep into the ground, some of them being as deep as this screen, 6, 7, 8 feet. And when we got small units like this, it was rather difficult to do some of the excavation. We thought we were going to be finding prehistoric stuff, but we found this ceramic bottle cap from a turn-of-the-century type of bottle. We found some very deeply buried materials. And once again, this shows the materials coming out of that site and some of the trees that we used to assign time periods to the erosion process. Well, one thing that became quite apparent as we were looking at these sites and the more recent record, let me get that a little bit better focus. It's hard to see this, but there's a series of sand layers up the top here which illustrate that in the past 200 years, especially the past 100 years, there's a renewed flooding episode on top of these old sites. This site dates to 8,000 years ago. And for 8,000 years, material remained in this matrix, but after the dam was constructed at the Rock Nick Point over in Rumford, sand started to be redeposited as a result of the dam on top of the site. It's not eroding it, but it's building the site. One of the things that we found that was also a major problem in excavating in the upper Androscoggin is the water levels occasionally will rise up in the river. And this shows our step ladder standing in the bottom of the unit with the water that's up about 3 to 4 feet in the bottom of the unit. So it gives you a sense of some of the difficulties. November excavation, water in the units. This is a 9,500-year-old site and down the bottom of the unit. This also shows some of the problems with that flood and the fact that this was the site we were working on 5 days before the water came up. We had excavation units here, and this was a result of a fairly quick runoff, but the entire site was inundated. And we got a chance to look at the direct reflection of what a flood would do to an archaeological site. And that's, again, looking just a little bit above the site when the water's down. Now, that's nice and calm, and it looks very easy to contend with. We found that the highway was constructed over a series of archaeological sites. And I thought that a number of them had been destroyed, but fill was placed on top of the sites, so there's at least 5 archaeological sites under modern highways. I think that they may be protected in that sense. This is one of the major things we had to contend with, was large-scale erosion. This is about halfway down the impoundment on the south side. And the landowner here said, Bill, yeah, he said my land used to extend out here another 30 or 40 feet. And grandparents and other folks remember it. He said this just slowly being scoured away. And you can see the high water mark back here. All along this eroded face, we found fireplaces, flakes of stone, pieces of pottery, and projectile points. So this shows the ongoing erosion of a fairly recent archaeological site. One of the supervisors standing on the site, which is most dramatic, is the fact that, again, 3 or 4 days prior to this, there was no water standing back here. And actually, the units that we excavated are underwater once again. And so it gave us a good sense of what was happening and how the raising and lowering of water influenced the sites. Well, out on the edge of the riverbank, Jennifer and I cut a face in order to focus archaeological samples, and we cut the samples out here, to define the history of the geology. This goes down an additional 5 feet. So the water came up, it comes in, and it's eroding this scarp. It gave us a good sense in terms of documenting what the erosion is like on the site. And it also helped us find a few more artifacts as it undercut here on the river. I think you can see that a little bit better, and this is the type of thing we do, collecting samples in little layers. And here's the water coming in. You also can see the layers that I've cut in the wall here to illustrate changes in sand size that reflect a high velocity river channel or a low velocity river channel. What is most interesting is up here there were many little bird nests in through this strata where the archaeological deposits are. So the birds had pulled artifacts out, sort of reworked and muddled around the archaeological record. That's a view across to the other site on the other side. As you can see, it's quite beautiful out here, and it looks good until you see that poison ivy running down the bank. Well, the people down at Boise Cascade said, well, the water was high, but I don't think it was that severe. And I said, well, I think it was pretty severe, so I went down to take photographs of water going over the roll. They have to measure the height of the water. The people that have gone through Romford think it's at least recall this area. And this is up to the upper part of the dam, and this is water that's going over the top of the dam, the flashboards. And I talked to the representative who we worked with from Boise Cascade, and I said, well, the water was at least 4 to 5 feet above its normal level. He said, no way. Absolutely no way. Water would never be that high. He says, it's never been that high in my lifetime. And I said, well, I said, I can assure you it's 4 to 5 feet high. He said, let's go call CT Maine down in Boston, because they control the figures on the dam. Called them up on the phone, they said, yes, November 17th was the highest water mark in the last 100 years going over the top of the dam. I said, what day did you do that? He said, November 17th at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, we took the measurements. He said, well, you got a good case here. This is getting down to the prehistoric period that I'm most interested in. This is an archaeological site that has been nominated to the National Register of Historic Places. Like your building here, which is an historic structure, this is a prehistoric site that has been nominated and I believe will be one of the most significant sites in the Upper Androscoggin. We've been very cautious about providing the locations of the site so that they can be protected. But this site is behind McDonald's, down the town of Rumford as you come up Route 2, and there is a boat landing area just over here. And I offer that because the site is so riddled with poison ivy, the roots are at least 5 feet deep. It's a nice place to go, to stop, and to get out and look, and to think, yes, there were 3 or 4 hamlets here with 8 or 10 people living in them, roughly at the time when Champlain was sailing along the coast. These people have yet to discover the poison ivy. We had a number of schools and kids come out to investigate the sites, and boy, I had all I could do to keep them out of the poison ivy areas and playing with the sand. And you can see one of the things that we are contending with, it's a big buildup of sand, very loose consolidation. And this shows a nice view down the river. We're excavating right on the river edge. This site is eroding quite rapidly. It is one of the most rapidly eroding sites that we have found in the uplands. As we are digging down, we start to see these black layers. And I've got a film cap here, a lens cap. These black layers in this particular site were filled with organic material, burnt seeds. This archaeological site provides evidence of extensive plant use by the native communities. I believe that if we excavate enough units through this area, which will be part of the relicensing program, we will find corn, bean, and squash agriculture at this location and several others in the impoundment. And this will be one of the northernmost extensions of that type of agricultural pattern. from any of the other units you've seen. A dark zone, a white layer, a lighter zone, a white layer. These two layers reflect a flood episode in which clean white sand flooding down the river at high velocity covered over a prehistoric occupation. This occupation below this white sand here dates to about 500 years ago. This layer in here is about 300 years ago. This represents the best sequence of culture and artifacts of the late woodland or the more recent prehistoric period. Well, you get a better sense of somebody excavating here to see those layers. What is interesting is there is a number of historic artifacts in this layer, some of which are European trade goods. Pieces of pipes, fragments of metal, that show that the people in this layer were in contact with the Europeans, and the people down here were pre-contact. So it has a particular significance in that sense. And you get a better sense of the unit and the fact that this layering is uniform. What is most important about the site is we were standing here and I kept moving my feet thinking, boy, this ground is awful soft. It feels like quicksand. We took a 3-inch aluminum tube, set it here, and it was about 20 feet long. And I said, let's push it in the ground and see if we can get a deeper soil sample. By hand, we pushed a 20-foot tube 18 feet into the ground, just like putting a knife, a warm knife, through butter. It pushed down to a gravel level, which contained wood. We think that that may date in the 12 to 14,000 year time frame, and the wood down there may reflect a period when the glacier was first receding from the uplands of the Androscoggin. This gives you a little bit better view in terms of the layer cake effect, and this is what is most important in archaeology, is called stratigraphy, this layer cake deposit. Sites like this are relatively unique. We have 200 sites in the Androscoggin, but we only have 3 sites that have very nice layering with prehistoric tools found in them. And boy, I'll tell you, I was really intent upon getting some samples to look at the history here. And so here I am on, I think, about November 25th or 30th in the rain collecting soil samples. And when your hands are wet and you get poison ivy, it sort of ran up my arms. This was like one of the most frustrating experiences. Okay. The types of artifacts. These artifacts were recovered in the uplands of North and Western Maine. These are the types of materials that were found at other sites in the impoundment. All 5,000 to 10,000 years of age. Fishnet sinkers, slate projectile points, gouges, woodworking. We found a number of these styles of artifacts near the dam on property that's owned by Boise Cascade. This is a view of that site in the wintertime, the one that we were just looking at, and Cindy's standing on top of the excavation unit. We came back to take photographs of the site in the winter to see what the ice looked like and the ice rafting. And it didn't impact it very significantly. It seems like that ongoing floods are eroding this more significantly than winter ice scouring. Again, a few more artifacts. These are the typical types of arrowheads and spear points found in the uplands. This one here is 9,500 years old. This is the style of projectile point found in the oldest archaeological sites in the Rumford. And these materials here are all younger in age, with these nice, colorful materials being the most recent in time, the last 1,000 or so years. Moving down the river, we're now down in the Pajebscot impoundment, very close to the head of tide of Merrymeeting Bay. I went to this site and knew that there was documentation by Samuel Purchas that 600 Indians were living in a village below Lisbon Falls. We worked for 2 months to try to find that Indian village, and this is one of the sites that produced remains similar to the Rumford area.
Maybe it will focus out a tiny bit.
This shows the general excavation unit. Same thing we found at Rumford, a big layer of sand. Next. This one here shows the river in the background. But what is most important is you see a dark layer, another dark layer, which are buried by flood deposits. In those dark layers, we found artifacts identical to the site over behind the McDonald's location in Rumford. Quartz stone tools. And you can see the distinctive layer cake. This layer right here was radiocarbon dated to AD 1200, 700 years ago. This layer here is dated to about AD 1600, close to the time of that historic village that was documented. This is a relatively bad photo, but it shows that nice layer in the ground, and there's a piece of pottery here identical to the Rumford location and identical to sites in Casco Bay by matching the style of pottery. And you can see this is a typical thing that archaeologists find, concentrations of little pieces of pottery. And believe me, there were 500 pieces here to put this thing back together. Sort of like a jigsaw puzzle, missing half the pieces, a few other puzzles thrown in. This is the pottery container. A wall of it, a paddle with string wrapped around it, or cordage, was impressed into the surface to compact the pottery together. What is most interesting is that the Androscoggin Valley shows a distinctive style of pottery and a distinctive manufacturing process. This is tempered with quartz and sand. All of the pottery from Merry Meeting Bay and Casco Bay up the Androscoggin is different than the Saco drainage, is different than the Kennebec drainage, and I think reflects a certain ethnic group, a tribal or cultural group that occupied the entire drainage. Well, in order to sort of relate the sites in the river drainage to the coast, we're going to take a look at an archaeological site out at Cape Elizabeth. And this site is particularly important because, again, the identical materials were found. Some of you that have been to Cape Elizabeth, this is the Great Pond, and this is the Alewife Brook. One of the things that we were also interested in, if there are significant floods that have taken place in the Androscoggin in the past 500 to 1,000 years, what have those floods done to the coast? Well, this is past October, and you can see that there's a sand deposit from the storm, a significant storm along the coast. And again, we're in an archaeological site located at the mouth of that brook. And here's Kathy down here. She's about 6 feet tall, so you can get a sense of how deep we are. Kathy has just come into archaeological materials that date to approximately 1000 to 1200 AD. There are virtually 6 feet of sand deposited on top of something that's only about 700 to 900 years old. This shows how dramatic the coast is changing. Well, I was interested in taking these cores, the same that we did at Rumford, and getting these big long tubes of sand out of this marsh. And Bryce Murray, the landowner, said, oh, this marsh is 25 feet deep. You can stick a probe rod right down into it. And he's just done that. I said, well, what about your garage? We've got a dump truck and a fire engine in there. Why isn't that sinking? And he said, well, I put 3 feet of concrete underneath it and 35 steel pylons. I said, well, I guess it's not going anywhere. He said, no, I drove it into clay. This is what we did over in Rumford. This is what we anticipate doing along the upper Androscoggin in the town of Hanover in the next couple of years. Sticking this tube down and shaking it with a cement vibrator into the ground. By shaking it into the ground and then cutting it in half, we can see the layer and the history of the earth, the history of sediment deposits. deposits. This shows the marsh that is formed on top of sand. The marsh that is formed on top of sand, which is on top of shells, which is on top of clay. This layer is 10,500 years old. The sand in between comes up to about 4,000 years ago, and the marsh begins building at 4,000 years ago. And you can see it just continues on with clay way, way down. Very deep layer of clay, about 4 meters or 12 feet. While everybody's fascinated with this, and it takes an awful lot of time and energy to take these out of the ground, and here we are cutting one of those columns and looking at the history of the coast of Maine. What the history shows us is some very dramatic changes in the past 5 to 10,000 years. Why this is of particular interest is you see here a buried archaeological site of the late woodland, a layer of rock from a storm, and another layer of occupation on top of it. This is sort of like a Pompeii for New England, in which houses, fireplaces, concentrations of pottery and stone tools were covered over by a significant coastal flood. And I thought, well, this is quite a major flood. I wonder what type of situation would create this flood. Well, here's the site. We're getting ready to dig some units. And you can see the lawn looks okay. There's a little sand from previous floods. Well, this is what it looked like after the October storm last fall. The storm came off of Portland Headlight and hit directly in front of Bryce Murray's house. There is a concrete set of stairs and a concrete slab that was on the beach. This thing right here weighs about 500, 600 pounds, so it gives you a sense of the intensity of the water hitting the site. It put down a layer of rocks on his lawn, which is virtually identical to those buried in that very deep sequence. Yes, and this shows his other little house nearby. He has a very good sense of humor, but when I asked him about mowing the lawn here and cleaning it up, he wasn't real happy about all the rocks here. One of the things that is really noticeable, and I just have a couple slides to show you this. Approximately 12,000 years ago, after the glacier was moving back from the Androscoggin drainage, the sea level rose to a high position because the land had a tremendous weight of ice on it, and it hadn't bounced back yet. It's interesting that the upper Androscoggin Valley is the first place that the glacier recedes from in the state of Maine. And that happens about 14,000 years ago. At that time period, and just after that, Sebago Lake was part of the ocean. Southern end of Sebago Lake was tied to the ocean, and then the land gradually started to bounce back after that mile-thick sheet of ice was gone from the landscape. It started to bounce back, and sea level dropped to a position 250 feet below its modern position today. Everything in Casco Bay was high and dry. This shows you the Casco Bay region. The site we looked at is out in Cape Elizabeth, Old Orchard Beach, Portland, and there's a series of rivers running down to a shoreline that's 9,000 years old. Along the coast of Casco Bay, we find no archaeological sites older than 5,000 years. They are all underwater. But in Rumford, up at Ziskahos Lake, in Richardson Lake, we find an abundance of sites that are 5 to 10,000 years old. This is the importance of the uplands. The archaeological record is here, but it's buried very deep in the river valleys. Well, the next one shows you what things were like around 3,000 or so years ago. And the sea level is very close to its modern position. One last site that I'd like to show you, which is very interesting and very much tied to the history of the Androscoggin, is a site on the north end of Mosier Island. And you can see these contour lines that show the underwater conditions. This 36-foot line is about 5,000 years ago. The 24-foot line is about 4,000 years ago. So Mosier Island was connected to the mainland as recently as about 4,000 or so years ago. We've excavated a site out here which matches the prehistory of the Androscoggin, and I think the people living in northern Casco Bay, not southern Casco Bay, not extreme eastern Casco Bay, were the ones that were tied to the Androscoggin drainage. This shows one of the sites we've been working on, which is being eroded rapidly with sea level rise. This was much larger 20 years ago. And in fact, about 15% of the land here has been lost in the past 10 years. This shows you why the site is particularly important. This is an Aboriginal grave that dates within the last 500 years. There are 14 individuals in this grave. Adult male, female, who was 7 months pregnant at the time of her death. Copper and shell bead necklace. A young female with a sewing kit in front, and a number of infants, two small infants on his feet, and about six burials that had eroded into the ocean. By doing a chemical analysis of these human bones, we could find out what the diet was like. These people consumed mostly marine foods. The old saying, you are what you eat. If we look at the chemistry of an individual's bone, we can find out if they are eating domesticated plants, if they are eating marine fish, or if you are eating terrestrial foods such as deer, beaver, bear, or muskrat. There is no evidence of agriculture in these burials. So it suggests, by looking at the chemical analysis, that agriculture only arrived in the Androscoggin and the Saco drainage is about 200 to 300 years prior to European contact. And that little excavation was in this block here, which is the size of the screen. I must admit that that was a difficult thing to excavate, and we only excavated it because it was being extensively eroded. This just shows the grid system we used, but all of the stuff that was lost from our first mapping of the site, especially on this end here, to the most recent excavation. Well, what is most important? The arrowheads that were found in that grave and in that site matched the arrowheads being found at Rumford, matched the arrowheads being found in Ziskahawson, Rangeley, and Richardson Lakes, matched things found in Dixfield, in the Gulf Island Project, in the Pajevskot Project. So these points show that the people living throughout the drainage were tied together in terms of their technology. One last little shot of this Mosier Island shows the rocky, eroded coast out here. And it shows one item which is unique. It's very much nondescript in a slide form. We found a small site on Mosier Island that dates to AD 1650 to 1670. This is a French token with a tiny hole perforated in it, probably for a necklace. This is the only French token found along the shores of the Gulf of Maine. And it dates to a time of King Philip's War. I am convinced that this site on Mosier Island is one of the locations in which the Native Americans were driving the Europeans out of North Yarmouth and getting prepared to go out to Jewel Island where the Europeans had moved in order to push them during King Philip's War out of the northern part of Casco Bay. This particular token is now on display at the Maine State Museum. And it's just a little tiny thing which was not real easy to see when we were excavating. But because it is a French token that shows details and can be dated, it's important in showing that there may have been a French tie to the Indians in this part of the bay. Something that people hadn't anticipated, especially the folks excavating at Castine in the recent years. I have a few photographs that show what I've been interested in the past 2 years, which is trying to find the folks of the Androscoggin the folks of Casco Bay. And this is a 1619 map of the Northeast. This is the Gulf of Maine, St. Lawrence Valley, and the Androscoggin is up here somewhere. It is not very well defined at this time period. This is an illustration of the later 1600s, which shows a large lake here, St. Lawrence drainage, and the coast of Maine. The Kennebec Valley makes its first appearance. The Androscoggin is represented by these two large wild critters. There is no definition to the Androscoggin. This is the late 1600s, the time of that French token. Yet another map, which is the early 1700s, and amazingly enough, someone has a thoroughfare going from the Gulf of Maine to the St. Lawrence. There was a little bit of propaganda that went along with the maps that were making their way back to Europe. I think this is supposed to be perhaps Moosehead Lake, but the Gulf of Maine is here, and there is again no appearance of the Saco or the Androscoggin drainages. However, you see the nice definition of these fishing areas up towards Nova Scotia. When we get into the more recent early 1700s, we start to see definition. Norumbega, the fabled city of gold here in the Kennebec Valley, another, I think, promotion to encourage people to the Northeast. They didn't find that gold, but they found cold weather instead. We start to see the Saco drainages, Casco Bay, and just a little bit of inroad is made. At this time that this map was made, most of the Native Americans throughout this portion from Cape Cod to the Kennebec River had been afflicted by various diseases. Smallpox, perhaps bubonic plague. Smallpox eliminated about 90 to 95% of the natives living along this section of the coast. And this is particularly interesting because I believe the folks in the Androscoggin drainages managed to live through the epidemics because they were not intimately connected like the folks down here. All corn farming villages were lost. The hunting, fishing, and gathering people to the north survived. The disease afflicted villages, but dispersed people, pockets of them, managed to survive through the epidemics. And as you get into the later 1700s, the quality of maps varies significantly. People interpreting maps from previous constructions, and you see a series of dams going up the river here, and another hopeful connection of the Kennebec and the Chaudière River. This is one of the maps that is particularly interesting to me, the mid-1700s, because you start to get the first definition of the river drainages. What is interesting is after you get into the 1700s, the river drainages in the Gulf of Maine show structures and Indian populations in the drainages, these little figures of them. So it means that they still were living in the upper part of the drainages and all through the maritime provinces. And getting into the most recent, when you start to see New England, the definition of New Hampshire, the Kennebec, and there as we move up, the first good sign of the Androscoggin drainage. In reading some of the accounts of the cartography and the construction of these maps, Androscoggin was characterized as a narrow, deep, rocky valley with little floodplain and little potential. And it's interesting to look at that characterization of some of the lower stretches of the river above Merry Meeting Bay. When you get up to Rumford, you get into a wide, nice, rich floodplain, which I think is sort of a refuge for some of the cultural groups. And this is the last one where we start to see some real clear definition of the drainages. We start to get up into the stretch of the Androscoggin. We're going to spend about 2 years going through all of the maps of New England, especially the maps of Maine, to sort out the Saco, Androscoggin, and Kennebec drainages. And I'm actually fortunate that the University of Southern Maine has an extensive map collection donated by Harold Osher to the university. think his collection is valued at about $8.2 million. It's the most extensive collection of maps of the New World in New England that is available in the Northeast, with the exception of Harvard and Yale universities. Well, this is what archaeology is most about for folks, and that is collecting arrowheads, and this is one of my students getting down to the real basics. And last shot. This is a view of the upper Androscoggin on the very last day of our project, and looking at the low water. Great. And it's not just like having a jigsaw puzzle with pieces missing. It's like only finding two or three pieces of a much bigger jigsaw puzzle. This is the diagnostic pottery, or the type that is found in the Androscoggin, which has that facet impression. But it's of a very, then I would leave nice items in the wall so that we could photograph them and say, that's where the material is coming from. Because we obtain charcoal and organic material for radiocarbon dates. And this is one of the ones we have a direct radiocarbon date on.
My father used to plow
up an arrowhead down on the pond on the pine. When I was up here before, and doing some research, we found a number of folks that had plowed up materials along the river here. And in fact, what is most interesting about this pottery and the site I showed you with the nice layer cake effect is that almost all of the sites that are 2,000 years old are within 1 foot of the surface and have been plowed over extensively. It's only in unusual condition that you get those deep buried sites that are very old and very recent. Yes.
Yep. You find these on both sides of the river, the same area, or just on one side?
Just on one side of the river. As the river, and you can see the river meanders and cuts. Mm-hmm. Materials tend to be on the higher ground, and they tend to be on one side of the river, and they do not match village across. Only when we get down to the falls do we find stuff on both sides of the river. But sometimes we're finding stuff 200 to 300 feet, as much as 1,000 feet away from the river, on what are old terraces. I think most of you have been out in the river, know as you walk along the floodplain, you go and it dumps down to another layer, and drops down to another layer. There's so much change in the course of the river that there are sites that are some distance away. Yes?
If there's been a bend in the river, do you usually find it on the inside of the bend or the outside of the bend?
Well, we tend to find it on the outside of the bend, but it depends on how that is meandering. Sometimes we find it in the bottom of the river and it's been fully eroded. That is the other thing that's important, is a lot of sites have been totally eroded and changed in their context. What we're really looking for is house features, fireplaces, concentrations of arrowheads, concentrations of pottery, and concentrations of plant remains. It's sort of like having this structure here. Having a house, having a barn, having fireplaces, and having the objects arranged around. Well, these are a little less dramatic than anything in this house, but to the archaeologists, they're very, very interesting. Most of the sites have been altered to some extent from flooding. We did learn as we looked at that flooding episode across the river that there were nice big layers of sand put here, and those whole layers of the plow field just sort of washed a few inches of sand away. And well, if there were artifacts there, they might have gone downriver as well.
Why did you choose Brentford Point instead of Bethel, for instance? You knew that was possible.
We knew that there were sites there, about 35 locations. And actually, from the work that we did down there, I now have a better sense of where the sites are up here in Bethel. We've looked over in the town of Hanover, and there's a small brook that comes in, and we found sites there 6,000 to 9,000 years that are about 400 feet away from the river. So we've been trying to get a history of the geology, knowing how the river changed, so that we can predict where those materials will be found. And I think that there are many more sites to be found out there, but there's a heck of a lot of digging in order to get down to the right layer or the right situation. I know that up here in Bethel, it was kind of frustrating when we worked over at the airport. I looked through the area and people had a few axes from this field or a few arrowheads from that field that had been plowed up, but it was hard to find a good intact village site. Now we know from looking along the high ground, not just the floodplain, but up high bluffs around the river, that there are also sites up there as well. And people had not looked in those areas, and I think that we'll start to find more and more of them. There was a condominium complex built, which is called the Chamberlain Resort. While we were doing an environmental study for the folks some years ago, we found two prehistoric sites up where the structure of the condominium structure is located. And both of those sites, we think, are about 5,000 to 8,000 years old. No one had ever looked up there before. But now we're saying, well, why did we not look up there? Because we assumed everybody lived near water. And so the history is complicated, but it's being unraveled in a pretty fast-paced fashion. Yes?
Across from that Chamberlain Resort, that right side of the road, there's this big hummock. And I always thought, I listened from the point.
Yeah.
But I always thought that was an Indian burial ground. I always wondered why they hadn't bulldozed that over just to see what's under. It's been there for years.
Yep.
Ever since I've been a kid.
Well, I can tell you something.
You know what I mean? Where it is?
I know exactly what you mean. And that's the first thing that I was looking at when I went out there, and I'm thinking, well, that looks awful much like a mound, but they're not on that scale up in this northeast area. Burial mounds have been found in New Brunswick. They have been found in the coast of Maine. They've been found in Vermont. I don't think it is a burial mound, but there is Indian material the whole length of that river terrace. Every single little unit that we excavated, holes in the ground, produced flakes of stone and pieces of rock.
I used to think, where we lived on the farm, there was one place I always wanted to dig in. I always thought it was a burial ground.
No.
My father used to find arrowheads all over it, and I always thought.
Well, there's a lot of professional archaeologists that will say, oh, I've heard that story before, that's fine. And they sort of brush it off, but time and time again, it's proving that you better take a look at those types of things, and I'm usually worth pursuing them. I don't know about the feature over in Chamberlain. For economic reasons, that resort project transformed itself, and we did not continue work on it because of the environmental process. I'm hoping that we can go back and do work in that project area with the new landowners, but it's something that's open to negotiation. Yes?
The material in the arrowheads, is that a local stone, or did they bring that in from some other place?
Well, that's interesting that you asked that. I brought along just a number of little flakes from different archaeological sites, and they show a light color and a dark color. Almost all of the stone is quartz or something we call ossipee or Berlin jasper. Mount Berlin in New Hampshire is a large rhyolite location where the Aboriginal folks quarry the stone to make their arrowheads. At least 60% of the stone in the Rumford Project came from that Mount Berlin jasper quarry. And anyone who's ever been over to Mount Berlin, at the bottom of the hill, there's enough flakes of stone to fill this room in terms of volume. The whole upper Androscoggin has Mount Jasper, and pretty much exclusively Mount Jasper. When you go down into the middle part of the Androscoggin, you see that same Mount Jasper making its way down there. But there's very little in Casco Bay. So that's one of our problems. To the folks in Casco Bay trading or obtaining local stuff on the coast, but it is very locally derived material, and it's quite descriptive, quite unique in terms of its color and characteristics.
Do I understand the oldest arrowheads had neck to them, and the more recent ones do not? That would represent a different way of attaching the arrowhead.
Yep, in a very simple sense, about 1,000 to 1,500 years ago, actual arrowheads came into use in New England. Prior to that, they were spear points. Everything was thrown with a spear thrower or on a fairly long shaft, and they're much larger in size. So it's only in the last 1,500 years that you get these little tiny arrow points, which are the traditional bow and arrow. It's a very recent invention. So the size is a function of the technology. That's why I think it's quite easy to assign it to a time period by looking at the style of material.
What do you estimate to have been the population, the Indian population, of the valley before European contact?
Well, the documentation suggests that there were at least 1,500 people in the lower part of the valley from Merrymeeting Bay up through Lisbon Falls. I would imagine, considering the broadness of the floodplain, the richness up here, probably valley-wide, we're looking at something maybe 2,500, 3,000 people. That's a very low density of people. The coast clearly supported more people in terms of the richness of resources. But it's very hard to get a sense because once agriculture took hold, populations grew very, very quickly.
Is the measurement the entire state of Maine, circa 1,600?
Actually, I would say an estimate maybe for the state of Maine would be in the range of about 10 or 15,000. It's hard, that's again very hard to say, because you've got to remember how the numbers were derived. Most of the numbers were derived on male warriors. Early records before the epidemic, how many? There were 500 Indians. All they were counting were males. They didn't count women, they didn't count children. So anthropologists have looked at the ethnographies to say, in the Saco Valley, there were 27 houses. Those 27 houses held an average of 8 to 10 people. So we make estimates of 270 plus or minus on the basis of numbers of houses. But that's also difficult as well. I think that there were probably more people here than we anticipated, especially in the coast. But when you look at the native populations today, they're very low, 2,000 to 3,000 in the real traditional way of life, maybe 5,000 to 10,000 out in the Maritime provinces in the Big Bend area. As you move into southern New England, the populations were much higher, especially those major corn farming villages on the Cape Cod, Narragansett Bay, Lower Connecticut Valleys.
Did you find any evidence in your diggings around Rumford Point of barge fires or any marine-related items, shells or anything like that?
Well, that's real interesting that you asked that as well, because at the site down by McDonald's, that late woodland site, we found soft-shell clam. And across the way, we found pottery that had shell used as temper. So it shows that somebody obtained shell to put inside the clay to make the pot that comes from a marine source. That's one of the things that we use to say that in the last 500 years, there's a lot of pottery from Rangeley Lake to Moosehead Lake that has shell in it. So they're either trading it or carrying it with them as small containers. And most hunting and gathering folks didn't carry an awful lot of stuff with them. You'd carry it down to the coast, but you're not going to carry it pop back up to the other place.
Why would there be clams in my little brook down home? There'd be clams, like you find.
Freshwater clams.
Yeah, are they common?
They're fairly common. The sand up here in a nice flowing, a little bit warmer environment produces a pretty stable population.
It's kind of strange because you don't always find them.
Yeah, in Moosehead Lake, I've seen quite a few areas where you have a lot of clams, a lot of freshwater clams. Pretty easy to find them. The raccoons get in there as soon as it warms up enough for them to get in the water. Find little mittens or little piles along the shore.
On the slide in which you had all the arrowheads lined up.
Yes.
One of them was named Neville.
Yes.
3000 BC.
Yes.
Why?
It's named Neville after Colonel John Neville, who lives at Amoskeag Falls in Manchester, New Hampshire. An archaeological site was excavated there that produced 100 of those style projectile points. They were measured and they showed to be a certain characteristic. For example, the lantern in the case back here shows a certain characteristic and might be defined as a type of lantern. They were defined as a Neville point and named after the person who occupied the land in which they were found. Those projectile points are found all through western Maine, New Hampshire, and as far south as Florida. So that represents a broad cultural way of life using the same type of projectile point. That's how we define artifacts. This pottery right here will probably be called an Androscoggin type or Rumford type, and we might have named it after a landowner. It's actually the town of Rumford owns the boat landing and the property. I'm not sure if we'll call this the town of Rumford style.